Welcome to the One Shot, One Life Show. Helping you win with money, people, fate, work, health, and your hopes and dreams. We help you stop worrying and start winning.
I will not waste my life watching the world go by. I've only got one shot. One shot, one life.
And now, welcome your host, best-selling author, speaker, CEO, husband, and dad. Doug Fitzgerald.
Well, welcome everybody to the One Shot, One Life Show. My name is Doug Fitzgerald. I'm your host today. Thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited that you're here. And I am super excited for this episode. This is our third episode. And today we're going to be talking about how to handle your money successfully during this crisis. We've been doing these shows for nearly 2 months now. And one of the things that people have been talking about and asking about is, how do I handle my finances during this time? You know, this is a time where, our lives have been turned upside down and people are struggling right now. And I think what it's done is it has really highlighted how we've either handled our money successfully or unsuccessfully leading up to this point. And then people are, really coming into crunch time. So we've got some great tips to be able to share with you. We've got a couple of great guests coming on, Jacqui and Jack. We should just call it the Jacqui and Jack Show. But Jacqui and Jack are going to share their experiences with their finances through the crisis and how it's impacted their lives, and specifically it's how it's handled their, or how it's impacted their businesses too. So I can't wait to hear more for them from them in just a couple of minutes. Now, before we get started, I want to thank you. Thank you for jumping on the show, watching, viewing, sharing, tagging people who you know will benefit from the messages we're getting out. From our last show last week, we've had nearly 1,000 views from that on all the platforms that we put it on. So we just want to thank you so much for just taking the time to watch and to support us. And we just ask you to continue to do that. So if you think the subject today would be helpful for people that you know, we would love if you just go ahead and click the share button on your screen right now. Share that to your page so all your people can hear about what we're going to share. And also, you can tag specific people too. And I think it'll be a great help and encouragement to them. And we'd really appreciate that. Plus, if you're following along on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, we'd love for you to like us, to follow us, to do all those good things and give us some thumbs up so we can get some support out there and continue to move on with the messages we want to bring. Plus, if you have any suggestions for shows coming up that you'd like more information about, private message us or contact us. We'd be happy to get that information. We have a lot of people that contact us throughout the week, and we'd love to be able to encourage you with that. Now, at One Shot, One Life, we help people stop worrying and start winning. And specifically, and these are the shows that we're going to create, specifically in the areas of money, which we'll talk about today, people and relationships, faith, work and career, health, and your overall hopes and dreams. And that's what we really focus on. We've got a book on our website. If you want to go there, oneshotonelife.com. We've got our book that you can purchase at amazon.com, anywhere fine books are sold, bricks and mortar, you can do that. We also have a couple of downloads. The first one is our theme song download by my dear friend Brian Olson. His band Voda recorded it, and they allow us to not only use it for a theme song, but you can get your own copy of that for free. Just go to oneshotonelife.com to get your MP3, and you can get encouraged. I ran with it today. I was running. I was getting all jacked up for the show, playing One Shot, One Life. So that's what it's for. Also on the page, you can download our 50 tips to help you stay connected when the world requires social distancing. This has been a great resource for a lot of people. We give you a lot of tips to help you out to stay connected with people and connect with new people. And I also outlined 3 specific things you can do every single day to help you navigate through the crisis that Corona is bringing us. So just a few little things that you can get when you go to our website at oneshotonelife.com. Now, so I've got a lot of, help behind the scenes. I've got my lovely wife, Tammy, who's right over here monitoring everything. And she's taking care of all the production business for me, or some of it. All right. And today's our first day where we have a live studio audience. We do, because Brad Bryan's over here, executive director at City Impact, and he's just a dear friend of mine, and he's helped watch One Shot grow and develop. He's helped us as well. So Brad's over here, and if you hear some hooting and hollering and clapping and all kinds of things, that would probably be Brad in the background. And if you want to pop in every once in a while, do a cameo, you can do that. So we're going to do all kinds of things, and we'd love to show your face in the cameo. So all you have to do is click on my name, make sure it's on my main page, put a comment in the section, and your comment and or question, if you want to ask a question for us, will show up, and then we can actually put you on the screen. So it can give you 15 seconds of fame if you want to as well. So not only do we have a live studio audience here, we've got a live studio audience everywhere on social media. So, all right, well, let's go ahead and jump on into our subject for today. Again, it's our episode number 3, how to handle your money successfully during this crisis. Two great guests, Jacqui Zimmerman, Jack Hayes. They're going to share their stories about how this crisis has impacted them financially. And then I'm going to share 6 tips. So grab a pen and paper, 6 tips for you to navigate successfully financially during the crisis. 6 tips I'm going to share with you. So make sure you grab a pen and paper and you can jot those things down. And again, we'd love to have your comments and be able to share them on the screen. So with that, let's go. What do you think? We go ahead and welcome our first guest. Should we like clap, drum roll? All right. First guest. All right, I'm going to bring up Jacqui Zimmerman. Jacqui, you're going to come up in just a couple of seconds here. There you are. Hey, Jacqui, you're looking good. Can you hear me? Oh, let me unmute you.
Loved all the fanfare.
Yay! Super glad that you're here today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Jacqui is a dear friend of mine, her husband, Jared, as well. You guys live in Pennsylvania. You have a couple of boys.
Yeah.
And you are navigating through the crisis like everybody else is being impacted. Right. And you are a business owner and you also work. You're a registered dietitian. You're a mm-hmm. health coach. And I know during this crisis, you've been impacted personally and business-wise financially. So what I'd love for you to do is share your story with us today about how the crisis has impacted you and your family during this time.
Yeah. Well, thanks for having me on, Doug.
Welcome.
Yeah, so it's been a crazy time, to say the least. And, you know, I was kind of wearing a lot of hats before the crisis. So I had both an in-person presence with my business. I was a private contractor with a local gym to do some personal training, teach some classes. I was doing some in-person nutrition, you know, coaching, group coaching programs. And then I ironically was working on, I had actually, an office had opened up to me. So I was getting ready to launch an office where I was going to be able to take on more one-on-one clients just before coronavirus hit. So, so it was, a really big pivotal moment for me when that happened, you know, so that in-person presence that I had been building up kind of got swept from out from underneath of me. So I do still have an online component to my business. So it's just pivoting and learning more that now in this present moment, everything has to be done online. So it's been a really big shift to change that way of thinking. So
basically then your streams of income from those areas, were they mm-hmm. basically cut off then?
Yeah. Yeah, cut off. you know, the personal training is not happening right now. We're still under, in Pennsylvania, a shelter in place through the beginning of June. So I just really don't know. And then you never know how many people are going to be comfortable just coming into a facility.
Right.
We're lucky in that the gym that I work at is a small group training facility. So it's not a big box gym. But still, I just have no idea what the future could hold for that. And, you know, really, you know, that part of my job has gone away. I'm not, just to protect my family and to protect other people, I'm not seeing clients in an office setting at the moment. And I'm not holding in-person group classes. Obviously, I can't do that. So, yeah, that income stream or those income streams have gone by the wayside for the time being.
So with that lack of income streams coming in, then how has it impacted you and your family?
Well, I mean, it's been nerve-wracking, to say the least. You know, maybe it's not time for this yet, but I feel like with working with you, we are a lot less worried than we would have been had this hit and we weren't working in that mastermind group. So but yeah, it's definitely causing us to stop and say, hey, you know, we better save more. We better really pay attention to how we're managing our finances, because I don't know when this is going to end. I don't know what my, you know, I used to have some income streams that were very constant and steady. So I knew what I was getting in. Now it's a little bit shifted to where I don't know what each month's income is going to look like. So, it's really caused us to have to pause and really, you know, evaluate how we're spending and really trying to save money more.
Yeah. You know, you had referenced being part of our mastermind group. So I'm going to go ahead and share a little bit about that. At One Shot, One Life, one of the things that we are now creating is what's called You Versus Money. And one of the passions of mine, Jacqui, is helping people with their finances, their basic money management. And you know that. You've been part of the group for a long time. Mm-hmm. To tell a little bit of our backstory, as it was 23, 24 years ago when Tammy and I had our first child, Dylan, and I was living off of pastor's income, and that was it. We were over $30,000 in debt. We had car loan, student loan, credit cards, and we were barely making it. Actually, we were going in the hole each month. And I remember looking at my son one day. He was standing up in his crib and thinking, I don't want my son to grow up not having the opportunity to pursue his hopes and dreams if it has anything to do with the way I'm handling my finances. Because what was happening at the time, Jacqui, I don't know if you knew this, but my wife, Tammy, who's sitting right over here, her whole dream, her whole life has been to be a stay-at-home mom. I call it work-at-home mom. Mm-hmm. So I believe moms that are at home work their tails off. You probably know that now. I mean, it's just like crazy. But that was her dream, right? And it was slipping away because she had to go back. She had to go get a job. Mm-hmm. Because of the way we were handling our finances and wasn't allowing her to stay home. That crushed mm-hmm. me. And so we sought, and I'm going to talk about some of the tips today, but we sought out the best advice we could to get our finances on track. About 3 to 4 years after that, we had paid off our debt. We had saved up in an emergency fund. We'd saved up 3 to 6 month living expenses. And over the last 20 some years, we've been able to invest in our future, our family's future, give like we've always wanted to give. But I've been working with people for the past 15 years, helping them with their basic money management skills. And so that's culminated in what we call You Versus Money. So part of what we're providing at OneShot are mastermind groups, people of like-minded people trying to pursue a specific goal together, to cheer each other on, to pick each other up, to learn along the way and succeed at what they're doing. So getting back to your reference, you are part of a mastermind group where we have technically three couples in that group. Mm-hmm. And we're all working towards, helping you get on a good spending plan, save up for an emergency fund and start prepping for the future. So we started that group, which is interesting, right before, this whole virus thing hit.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about what it was like before you joined the group with your finances at home. What was that like?
I think that it was mostly that neither one of us had a good picture of, you know, where the money was going. And neither one of us had a strong financial education. I hate to say that if my parents are watching, but we just, just really didn't know. We didn't know, where do we put our money? How do we save? How do we make sure, that we're paying bills and creating that surplus of income to be able to save and save up that emergency fund? We just really weren't. We were just pretty clueless about that. So if we had still been in that state and this crisis had hit, I mean, we probably would have been really biting our nails and really, really nervous. But just the start of the group and just getting a picture and writing down, what our expenses are and just really getting a firm budget and starting to create a plan, our finances look a whole heck of a lot different now. I mean, actually, I think we're probably going to come out of this much better off than we went into it, which is really, really saying something since our income has dropped drastically. So that's huge. And the fact that we already have an emergency fund and are on our way to having, at least a month's worth of income saved up and, in the wings, I think is just really telling that we've been able to do that throughout this crisis. So
I'm super proud of you and Jared because you have. I mean, over the last few months, you've saved up an emergency fund, which you wouldn't have had before. You've got a clear, what we call spending plan, so you have surplus money at the end of the month. Mm-hmm. Now you're telling your money what to do, right? And now you're saying, all right, we got this extra money. What can we do? We're going to start paying off debt next. That's mm-hmm. the goal, right, for you guys. Yep. And then at that point, then the world's your oyster, because then you're going to have all that surplus income to take care of all of the fun and needs and dreams that you've always wanted. So super job with that. Let's talk a little bit about your career in business. Mm-hmm. I believe there's always opportunity in crisis. Mm-hmm. And one of these opportunities was you started taking care of your finances. But another opportunity, I think, is, and we talked about this, you mm-hmm. and I did, about your business now, because you realize that our life is going to be totally different now with the crisis. Yeah. So what are you thinking about then in regards to your business as you want to move forward? What are the opportunities that are available to you?
Yeah. Well, you know, I've known for a long time that just doing one-on-one coaching, I mean, that's not sustainable, you know, for me too, because I only have so many hours in the day. And with now homeschooling, or, you know, having the kids home all day and, you know, just wearing so many hats, you know, some days I feel like I'm a IT person too, with, you know, handling tech issues with everybody trying to be on computers at the same time. And, you know, that, you know, just doing one-on-one isn't sustainable. So, and now, you know, a lot of people might not be able to afford the cost of a one-on-one coaching relationship. So, you know, moving to a model where I'm doing some group programs is, you know, I've been doing that in person, but now moving those groups online, because, you know, there's so much uncertainty. And I think I have people that are local that choose virtual coaching versus having to come in. It saves time. It saves them gas money. I mean, it's so accessible, especially if, you know, they need to do it during their workday and just call me on their lunch break or whatever. So now, you know, moving groups to that online space, I think, is going to be so important, because people can stay home. They don't have to go out. They can still get that group camaraderie that I think is so, so important, but without going out to an actual group where they're putting themselves at risk. So
I'm super proud of you, because that now you're looking at new opportunities for income streams now with your business and just shifting it, right? Just shifting it a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I think for all of us, myself included, we've been looking at that. I think people, if you're watching this today, I'll talk about it in a little bit. Definitely look at different ways of streams of income and realize that online platforms are going to be the wave of the future. Mm-hmm. It's just the way the government is developing the infrastructure. It's where we're going. And now we're realizing with this crisis that it's just a great platform, not just to communicate, not just to do fun things like this, but to also create income. Mm-hmm. And or to continue income and develop that. So before I jump into some of these tips, is there anything else that you want to share? You know, anything that's on your mind or heart?
No, I mean, you know, I think that doing the group has just showed me how great it can be to go through a process of change with a group, even if it is virtual. You know, you kind of think that something gets lost in that translation, but really it hasn't. I mean, I think I love the way in the group we're all cheering each other on, sharing ideas and everything. And, you know, I've known for a long time that that's where I need to go, but this just solidifies it, because look how much we've all accomplished just because we're working together at it, all towards a common goal. I think that's real powerful. So,
yeah, it's awesome. We have a great group. It's so fun. Every night we meet, like, it's just, you know, we keep talking like we'd like to get together sometime, like literally in person one day.
That'll require flying for all of
that
us.
That will. We'll have to figure that one out. I don't know. We're going to have to get a hazmat suit or something, and we'll just get together. So, okay. Well, Jacqui, thank you so much for opening up, being vulnerable and transparent. I know it's going to be a real encouragement to people that are watching today. I'm going to put you in what we call the holding tank for a little bit, and I want to bring you back on at the end. And one of the things, if you would just think about this, I want you to talk about how going through this financial training, really, how you've interacted, how you've shared that with your sons. You got two boys at home.
Okay.
Okay. And yeah. And kind of what that's been like to start teaching them in the process so that we're duplicating the learning. So, all right, very good. Well, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna put you, so I'll bring you back though. Don't go away. All right. Isn't she awesome? I love Jacqui. Jacqui and Jared are just great. They've been a huge encouragement to me, and they're a valuable part of our group. So here's what I'd like to do. Jacqui did a great job kind of setting up what we want to talk about next. I want to give you 6 tips for financial success during the crisis. So grab a pen, grab a paper. I got Jack in the holding tank. Jack, I'm going to be bringing you on here in just a second. All right, buddy. Sound good? All right. He's there. All right. Okay. So tip number one, I'm using S's today, by the way, lots of S's. I just tried to say, how can I do this with a lot of S's? So here we go. Tip number one, seek out a solution. All right. Here's what I mean by that. If you're struggling with your finances right now, now is a great time to start thinking about how can I educate myself? How can I educate my family? To start taking advantage of the finances that we have coming in. The first thing that I like Jacqui, I didn't really know how to handle my finances. Tammy and I were both just kind of winging it. So what I decided to do was seek out any information I could find for finances and how to handle them. Back then it was Larry Burkett, Ron Blue. That's pretty much about all we had. So I dug into that information. The second thing we did is we sought out an older couple that were highly successful with their finances to kind of walk alongside us and to help us. Here's what I want to encourage you with is this. We have the You Versus Money platform now. We've got different ways that we can work with. We're going to be starting a new mastermind group up fairly soon. So if you're interested in that, you can private message me and get in hold of us on social media or go to our website, connect there at oneshotonelife.com. The other thing you can do on the website is go to the one-on-one coaching. I will coach you one-on-one if you want me to. All you have to do is go there. So just make sure that if you're feeling crunched with your money, don't just sit there. I always tell people there's opportunity in crisis. Don't stick your head in the sand. Now is an excellent opportunity to spend some time seeking out a solution for your situation. All right. And the other thing I wanted to share is this, and I've shared this with my kids. It's really important to understand that each single dollar that you earn represents a moment of your time. It literally represents a heartbeat. I mean, seriously, you only get so many heartbeats in this life, and you're exchanging those heartbeats for dollars. If that's the case, I just want you to think about this. If that's the case, I recommend that you highly take advantage and protect and guide those dollars in the correct places. You don't want to just kind of let them slip away. If they're representing an exchange of your time and your life, then I think it's vital that now's the time to really get serious about learning how to handle the finances. And what we say, tell your money what to do rather than your money telling you what to do. All right, step number two for financial success during the crisis is solidify a spending plan. And Jacqui really, she talked about this quite a bit. Again, it's telling your money what to do. A lot of people just live life and they never have a specific plan of knowing where their money's going. You don't even know what your perfect situation is. The first thing we teach in our You Versus Money class is we want you to know exactly what your financial situation is. It opens up your eyes. We want you to know what is all your debt? What is all the income that you have coming in? And how much are you spending? And I'm telling you what, people get shocked at the amount of money that they spend because you never really think about it. You go through the day and if you don't have a plan, you're just kind of spending here, spending there. And the next thing you know, you don't have any money at the end of the month, right? And so we want to make sure that you have surplus income. So making sure that you have a spending plan that's in place. One of the things I had, Trey Penninger is a good friend of mine. He's a great finance guy here in Lincoln. He had shared with me some tips earlier this week. And it's one of the things that we teach in the You Versus Money course is this. People say, well, how do I get my spending under control? You tell your money what to do by having specific spending accounts. We teach having 3 specific spending accounts. If you have, you know, spending money on your mortgage and your utilities, those fixed expenses, that should be 1 checking account or 1 debit account. And that's all that money's for. And the next one's going to be spending for household items and groceries and everyday living expenses. And then the next one, the final one would be where you want to save, right? You want to have your emergency fund. And each time you get your check coming in, whether it's once a week, twice a month, once a month, you know percentage wise where and how much of that money is going to go into each account. And then once you have the money in there for a specific period of time, maybe it's for a week, for 2 weeks spending, whatever it might be. Once the money's gone, guess what? The money's gone. Which means you have to learn how to reallocate that money for your spending plan. So you want to make sure you do that. One of the things that in our group that people had, the I guess was the most shocking expense that they didn't realize where money was going to. Jackie's laughing right now. I'm just going to bring Jackie up and you're going to tell me. I know you know what it is. I'm not even going to say it. We have not talked about this before. Did we, Jackie? I didn't tell you. I'm going to ask you, what was the one expense in all three couples that was the most unexpected and the most expensive?
The food budget.
Groceries. Food budget, right?
Oh, we were shocked. We were like, what? I mean, how do we spend that much money on food? And the boys open the refrigerator and say there's nothing to eat.
That and what you guys did was, it was for all three couples, right? It wasn't just you guys.
Yeah, right.
So it was, everyone was shocked. But here's what you guys did. You started talking to your boys about that you're trying to learn how to handle your finances. But the first way you did it was by showing them what you were expending with food, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And kind of getting them on board of the expense.
Yeah, we're like, every time you say there's nothing to eat, let us show you how much we spent on the food budget this month.
And they've kind of come in now and they're starting to learn.
They're starting to get it.
They're starting to get that there's an expense there and you just can't, you know. So, all right. Well, thank you for popping in. That was totally unexpected. So thank you for thank you for being willing to play. So I'll put you back in the whole thing. I might pop you back up again. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
All right. So you might want to be ready for that. So yeah, grocery expense was one of the top ones. Here's what I want to encourage you to do. If your money's really tight right now, look at your spending plan, clean it up. The second thing is this. I want you to pay the bare minimums if you have debt. Listen close to me on this, though. Take the excess money that you might be spending on top of that, put it in a savings account. We want to make sure that if there's an expense that comes up, that you don't go in further into debt. Make sure you put that extra money into a savings account and save it there. Don't spend it. And then the next thing is do all you can to make sure you pay your bills on time. And I can go real deep in each of these points, but I just wanted to hit on this one real quick. Banks and companies out there are going to encourage you to put off your payments. Here's the thing about that. The reality is you're still going to have to pay them. That's the truth. And you may not know that they may charge you either extra interest or a penalty with that. So do all you can at this point to make sure you're staying on track with paying your bills, paying your debt payments. And if you, like I said, if you've got debt payments, if you're paying off extra, I would encourage you to take that extra right now, just for a couple of months here, put it in your savings account. If we come out of this crisis and everything good is good, like the people in my mastermind group, they're going to take that money and they're going to turn right around and either put it in their emergency fund or start paying off debt. So you're still going to have that money there, but we want to make sure that you're taken care of during this crisis. All right. Tip number three for financial success during the crisis is search for solutions. So if you're having a hard time right now with your finances, you can either cut back your expenses or you can create more income, or what is ultimate is doing both, right? So in our group, we have people learning about what are some new streams of income that I could create. We've got one member that is doing DoorDash now and was like earning a couple hundred dollars extra a week doing DoorDash runs. Maybe you can, we've got friends that are making masks and selling them. We've got another friend that is cutting up wood and selling it like hotcakes right now for fire pits and all that. Maybe there's a part-time job you can get, or maybe there's an online business you can start. But finding and looking for new streams of income could be incredibly helpful as you're looking for solutions to your financial situation. The other thing is this, be very aware of the CARES Act that's going on. Go online, search it out, search out the CARES Act. There's all kinds of information on there. I'd make sure that it's a government website or the Small Business Administration website, but go there and see what is available to you through the supplemental resources that the government is providing, both locally and nationally. So just make sure that you're aware of that, because there are great resources that can help you out. Here's another thing. We've had several people that I know filing for unemployment. And if you're in a dire situation where your income has been cut off, like where Jackie's was, unemployment might be a good option. You're already paying into that. The reality is, you know, if you're in dire need right now, now's the time to search that out and see what your options are. Student loan help. There is also student loan help that the government's providing. And if another thing too is there are local organizations, nonprofits, and churches that can help you out too. Hey, one tip that I thought was great that our group came up with was one of our members realized that their local school, their lunch program was still going on during this time. And they were still offering it to people. They could drive up and grab lunches, breakfast and lunch. And if they weren't going to use it, that food was going to get wasted. Did you realize that, Brad? So, yeah. So we've had several. Well, I don't know how many, I can't, at least two within our group would go and grab their school lunch. It's provided for free anyway. And if people don't use it, they throw it away. So they were getting breakfast and lunch for their kids. How crazy is that? So again, just search out resources that are available for you for the certain situation. All right, so here's what we're gonna do. We're halfway through the tips. And since we're halfway through the tips, I get to bring up my next guest. I'm gonna bring up Jack Hayes. Jack, you're gonna come up in just a couple of seconds here. Make sure I get you unmuted. Pop you up on the screen. All right, there's my buddy Jack. Jack, how you doing, man?
Hey, Doug, I'm doing great, buddy. Thanks, man.
Hey, Jack Hayes is Tammy and I's dear friend from down in Miami. You own Miami Tan. You're a business owner. You got a great girlfriend. You are highly successful in what you do. You're a hard worker. You're a dear friend of mine. And we've been friends for a long, long time. Sure. And I just want to say, number one, thank you so much for being willing to jump on here and encourage people by sharing your story. You got caught up in the whole mess, right, with your business. You own the business. You have, how many employees do you have?
We have myself and three other employees.
Okay, so he's responsible for three other employees. The virus comes about and literally shuts your business off at the knees, like boom, right? Out of the blue.
I mean, it was a nice shot right at the knees.
Okay, so Jack, would you be willing to share over the next few minutes just your story, how this crisis has impacted your business and your personal finances? Sure. And I've got some questions for you as well that I'm curious about too, so. Take it away.
Well, first of all, before this all really hit, Miami Tan was having one of its best years in probably 10, 15 years. And we were making plans for new additions to the salon, lots of new things to help increase the income coming in here, adding new staff and stuff like that. And then it was just like at a light switch, we had no business. We found out in one day that we had to close down. So it was a hard knock to take. Now, we were kind of not too worried because of the fact that we were thinking that it was going to be for 15 days is basically what they were going to say in the beginning here. Well, 5 days go by and you're kind of enjoying the time off and so forth. And we're not too worried. And then it's 10 days. Now, another thing I've got to tell you is that my girlfriend, Jenny, is a personal trainer and in the fitness business like Jacqui is. And she lost her job a week before I did. So she was without pay also. So we have a two income family and all of a sudden it's turning to zero income family. So anyway, it just goes into another month and then it's, 40 days. So it was scary. My history is the fact, and being a friend of mine and going through a lot of this, is that I have gone through a period like this back in 2008 where I lost one of my salons through a hurricane, not no fault of my own, but through a hurricane season. And it only, we had to close down. So what was happening, and I come from the age group, and my dad was a very, I want to say, non-emotional guy, and you don't like to show your emotions to people. So personally, inside my head, I was starting to get those feelings of what happened back in 2008 coming back, sneaking up on me. But I didn't want to show any fear. And so we talk about, mentally and personally what happens. That didn't help me with my relationship with my girlfriend. Because I didn't want to show emotions. I wasn't open. So, things can get a little bit rough, like we've probably all gone through here. Tensions get high. It's been a shocker. But we got great news yesterday. We were said that we were told that we're able to open up on Monday.
Oh, really?
So right now, I'm right here at the salon with my two employees, and we're cleaning up, sanitizing. I've got painted hands. I'm painting.
I wonder what that is.
So there's a rainbow, in the future here for us here. So we're very excited about that. But it was scary. It was very scary. We went from zero income. I was going from $35,000, $40,000 a month of income in the tanning salon to zero. And it's a shock, just like everybody else.
So give me, if you, and you don't have to, but if you, like, tell us a little bit more deeper of like how that impacted you emotionally. Cause you said you didn't want to show any emotion because you wanted to make sure you put on a good front, but how are you making it through that?
Well, it was hard and it still is hard because again, I'm a person that doesn't show much emotion. I don't talk about feelings that hurt me deeply because again, my dad said, never show your emotions. That's a sign of weakness. Don't let anybody know. Plus I want to be strong for Jenny and our two kids, which are four paws. You know, we had two dogs. So that's always, again, it's always in the back of the head. You got to be strong for everybody else. But in the reality, that can hurt because the communication lines, and I'm not a huge communicator. And if Jenny's online, she'll understand and be nodding her head. Yes. I'm not a huge communicator. I show more. I do more by showing.
Right.
So my defense mechanism, I would probably say, is by shutting down. Yeah. And that's the worst thing you can do when you're having to live with someone for 24/7. And Jenny is a communicator and she, you know, once we got over our little issues, she's the one that helps me communicate more.
Yeah.
She's the one that has me open up and not to be afraid to say my emotions or what's on my head. And it's still hard for me to do because it's not something that I find very easy. But personally, again, I'm 59 years old and those things start coming in the back of your head going, gosh, what am I going to do if I don't open my tanning salon because if I can't be around people? That's my business. I'm not lucky enough to have an online business. Or I am lucky, depending on how you look at it. You can't just, you know, you can't go online and get a suntan. You have to come see me. So, you know, it made me start thinking about some other things. What am I going to do? What's Jenny going to do? Yeah. You know, luckily, it sounds like we're going to be okay.
That's good. And I tell you what, that's gold what you just shared about just not going through this by yourself. That's one of the things that we teach, and especially in the book, is that's why we do mastermind groups. And that's why and then one of the things I know for you and I, we're friends and periodically, you know, we text back and forth and we do video messages and stuff. And it's just a great way for you to, I know for you and I know for me to be able to share with other guys kind of what we're going through a little bit. And it allows you to realize that number one, you're not alone. And number two, there are people out there that are willing to listen. And number three, there are people out there that are willing to help if needed as well. And right. So you sharing that was so good. So yeah, make sure that you're develop healthy communication with those that you love. And let's turn this back to your business now, especially with your employees. You know, now that you've been shut up for a while, look at that. You got business. It's ringing off. We yes. like that. They just heard on our show. They just heard you're opening up Monday. So now you're getting phone calls. I'm telling you, that's what happens.
Yeah, please.
But hey, you've got you've got a couple of employees there. You're starting to open up. You are telling me all that you're going to have to do to when you open up to protect people and how that's still going to impact your business. In other words, your business is not going to come back just like it was when you shut up when everything was shut down. You're going to have to make adjustments that are going to impact your income, your employees' income. And to also protect the safety of those of your clients. So tell us a little bit about that. The reason why I want you to share this is if you're a business owner, we want people out there to know that we're on your side. And we understand that there are things you're going to have to go through as this new normal changes. On the flip side of that, if you're a customer, just know that these companies out there support your local businesses, but also know that they're having to go through changes right now that they have no control over. And so to be patient, to be kind, and to be overly generous with your local businesses is my message if you're listening out there. And I know it's our message to Tammy and me too, is what we try to live out. So tell us a little bit about what that's gonna be like as you reopen on Monday.
Right. Well, proportionally, you were talking about the different loans and things people can get. We applied for the PPPL, which is the payroll protection loan there. We didn't get it the first time. They ran out of money. So again, during that period of time, it's like scary. How am I going to do this? And the fact is I have other people that rely upon my business, you know, for their income. So again, that's hitting at your head there too. So anyway, we were able to get it the second time around. It's not a lot, but it is allowing me and my staff to continue getting paid, being able to do a payroll and so forth. And also a little bit goes towards utilities. So that's one of the things. And if you're a business owner out there, definitely keep trying to do it if they haven't run out of money already. But yeah, that's definitely helped out. on the day-to-day basis type thing, we're used to doing anywhere from 50 to 200 tans a day.
Wow.
And with this change, we're having to do all new protocols. There is nobody going to be waiting in the lobbies. You're going to have to check in. We're going to have a table outside the tanning salon with a person manned, and that's good. So it means we're going to have three people on staff at all times, whereas we used to be able to do it with one person, maybe two. So our income, our payroll is actually going to have to go up now to be able to take care of what we need to be able to be open. So we'll have a person out at the front. We need to check them in, find out what kind of tanning bed they want to, and we have to take their temperature before they walk in and let them know that if they're showing any signs of colds, you know, temperature, anything like that, they're not going to be allowed to come in. So what's going to happen is your one-on-one relationship with your clients is really going to have to come to the forefront. And that's where we're also, like you just said, when you're on the other side of the coin and you're the client, do realize that everything that they're doing to be able to take care of you has totally changed. We're having to have masks. We're having to have gloves. We're having to have extra sanitation. We're having to have things that we've never had to have before in such large amounts. Luckily, in my business, it's really big on sanitizing, so we have no problem with that. That's not going to be an issue. The timing is what's going to be the issue, where if we had 9 tanning beds going at one time and we could have 10 people waiting in the lobby to go in, and it would only take us 5 minutes to get the red bed ready and turned over for the next person, it's going to take anywhere from 15, 20 to 30 minutes to truly get that person in there. So our income levels are going to actually go down because we're not taking care of the same amount of people. Also, we're going to run in with the situation where some people still may not feel quite safe or comfortable about coming into a place where there's going to be other people. So there's a lot of different issues there, but you're totally right. You know, when you go up to that store or that restaurant that you have enjoyed in the past, just realize their life has been totally turned upside down also, along with yours. But they're going to be doing the best job that they can to ensure that you have a great experience with them, so that when things do come back to normal, which I think, you know, there's going to be a different normal, but I think, you know, we're a great country and we're very, very strong and we bounce back from things. And, you know, I'm very optimistic on our future. I think this is going to get taken care of one way or the other. I'm not going to go further than that, but I think it's going to be okay. I'm looking forward to the future.
That's good. That's really good. And one last thing I wanted you to share is you shared with me earlier this week. There was one thing that you did, you started doing a couple of years ago that if you hadn't started doing, you don't know if you'd be okay right now.
Sure, sure. Well, absolutely. That was what you call the emergency fund. After going through my issue back years ago, I started thinking about where my money was going. And unfortunately, I'm not a savvy business person. I'm not a numbers person. I don't count my nickels, dimes, and pennies. So, of course, if the money's in the account, I would tend to spend it. Not frivolously, but I could get a few more extra bottles of tanning lotions, or I could do this or whatever. So what I started doing is every day I had made a second account at my bank, and I would take a certain amount of money, depending on what came in the previous day, and I would put it into that account.
Yep.
So I didn't see it. It was never spent. It was just, like you said, an emergency fund. And I'd been doing that for a couple of years. So when we, you know, got closed down, our expenses, we still had bills. Our landlord worked with us, but I still had to pay rents. Florida Power and Light still wanted their money. I'm like you. I do not believe in deferring payments to credit cards. So I continued making payments to credit cards. See, not crazy, but you have to understand in a business like mine, I may charge $10,000, $15,000 on a credit card, but the next month I'd pay it off.
Yep.
Well, those $10,000, $15,000 that I charged before we got closed down is still there. So you don't want to go bad on that. So we continue doing that. So luckily, by having that emergency fund, I was able to continue basically floating the business and not having to worry so much about no income coming in, because I did have actual income that was previous there, being able to pay the bills. So that was a huge help. And if I didn't have that, I don't know if I'd be able to continue. I really don't. And I also did that with my personal life too. You and I have talked about that before. I'm a big gold and silver guy. So I'd always had that there, sitting there. I had started some Vanguard mutual fund accounts that every week I take money out of my paycheck. I have another account in another bank where I just kept putting money aside. And I'm one of those people, again, if I can't see it, I'm not going to spend it.
Yep.
So that's definitely helped out through these last 2 months.
That's so good. That is so good. I'm so proud of you, my friend.
The other thing, can I say one more thing?
Sure.
You know, something that happened, you and I have talked about this before, is the fact that you can't worry about things you can't control. Right. And so two of the things that my girlfriend and I continued doing during this time, and I hope everybody's been doing this too, is you can control what you put in your mouth and you can control what you do with your body. And with everybody having all this time off, it's very hard to find the excuse that I can't work out or do something to maintain your body, which is going to maintain your mental capacity also there. So my girlfriend and I actually used this time. You know, we still were getting up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, go do our hour-long run and then another hour of weights. And you and I know about what kind of eating I'm doing. And, of course, that's that food, where the money goes towards food. I found that it was going up also because of that. I'm a meat eater. That's all I eat, carnivore. So, but, yeah, those are the two things that really helped us out, too, away from finances, but was to keep that, you know, the good mental part of our body and our mind.
Absolutely. Yeah. And we can encourage each other with that. So yeah. Absolutely. Excellent. Excellent information. Great tips. Thank you so much for sharing and opening it up. Cause that's not easy at times. And also appreciate you. And you're always such an encouragement. I hope that the people that are watching see that. And just like with Jacqui, I've got your contact information. I got Jackie's contact information in our description area of this post. So if anybody wants to get in touch with either one of them, all you have to do is go to the description area, click on their website. So there are links, Facebook page links too are there, and you can get in touch with them. So, Jack, thank you so much for being on the show today. I'm going to put you in the holding tank, and I might bring you back here in just a couple of minutes. Is that okay? All right. Sounds good. How about that? Jack is awesome. But I hope that I hope we're able to see the power of being in control of your finances. See, Jack, well, all Jack was telling us there towards the end was he was telling each dollar what to do. And let's get back into these tips, these six tips. We've got three left. We'll go through them really quickly. And then I'd like to bring them back on, and then we'll close out the show. But again, we're talking about six tips for financial success during the crisis. And tip number four, it goes right into what Jack was talking about. I call it save, save, save. That's it. Save, save, save. Try to do your best to save right now. I know you might think it's difficult. Just like my mastermind group thought it was difficult right when we started and the crisis hit. But the reality was, they were more intent on saving. I think nearly everyone in that group has saved up their emergency fund at this point, or very close to it, of $2,000 or more. They did it during the crisis. They found creative ways to make it happen. You can do it as well. And I guarantee you it's going to give you a peace of mind when you have that sitting there. And if Murphy happens, right? Actually, one of our members, their washer and dryer went out last week. They had money in the emergency fund. They didn't have to worry about charging it, where the money was going to come from. They had the money there to take care of it. And that's what emergency fund does. Just like with Jack, just like with Jacqui, you find yourself in a situation, a crisis, whether it's small or big, it can help you navigate through that time. So, and just like what Jack was saying too, you know, they're doing PPP loans for their business, but a lot of people are getting stimulus checks right now, right? You're getting that extra $1,200 or $1,800 if you have kids or whatever it might be. And if you're married, it might be $24,000 to $3,000 a month from the government. Here's my recommendation. Take those checks, put them in the savings account. Don't touch them. It'll always be there, right? But get through the next couple of months and it could be a lifesaver for you. I'm afraid a lot of people are going to take those checks and say, all right, I want to get that next level of TV, Brad, or I want to get that next set of golf clubs, but that's not what we want to do. We want to put that in a savings account. All right, tip number five, suspend the shopping. Oh, no, I know. I just heard a bunch of boos. Suspend the shopping. Here's what I mean by that. It's very simple. Don't go into any more debt. Now is not the time just to go into debt. Charge extra things on the credit card. Do what you can not to go into debt. And if that means, you know, you suspend the shopping for a little bit, that's all right, you know. Hang out with your family a little bit more. Enjoy the outside, the outdoors. Get some exercise, clear your mind. But tip number five, suspend the shopping and don't go into any more debt. And then our final tip to share with you today is this. Oh, listen close to this one. This could be a life changer. This one tip could change generations. And I'm not kidding. Can change generations. Listen close and write this one down. Tip number six for financial success during the crisis. Submerge your kids in the solution. Submerge your kids in the solution. Here's what I mean by that. You're going through the crisis. Allow your kids to go through this. Obviously, age appropriate. There's certain things they can comprehend and learn, but teach them about how to handle their money during this time. Don't let this opportunity go to waste. This is a great opportunity to teach your kids. We talk to our kids all the time about how are they handle their finances, especially now during this time. Our son gets a stimulus check. What's he going to do with it? How do we handle our finances and our budgeting? Our daughter getting an apartment next week, I think, moving in. And how do I get on my good spending plan that keeps me within my budget range? What is my income coming in? And what does that look like? This is a great opportunity for you to show your kids how to start taking control of their finances. Imagine this. What would it be like if your kids had all their financial situation figured out by the time they became a functioning adult and started getting a good income coming in? Their life would be dramatically changed forever. And that's what we want, is we want to change generations to come. So make sure your kids are walking through this process with you at the same time. I just think it's a great tip for you to really consider. The last thing is this. I want to share with you one more time is, we have a program called You Versus Money. I can work with you one-on-one. You can go to my website and check that out. We've got a new mastermind group that will be starting up in a couple of months, most likely. You can check that out. This fall, later in a couple of months, we're going to start up a membership site. Hopefully, it'll be our next book. So stay tuned with that. But if you need any help with your finances and we can help you out, we do six things that we work with when we work with people. First thing is this, we help them get a clear picture of their current financial situation. The second thing is we help them get on a good spending plan. So you have money at the end of the month left over. Number three, we help you save $2,000 in an emergency fund. Number four, we help you pay off your debt, excluding your mortgage initially. Number five, help you save up 3 to 6 months of living expenses. How would that be right now if you had that set aside? And then number six, we teach you how to save and give for your future. So make sure you get in contact with us if you want or need any help in those areas. So I'm going to bring our buddies back up for one last little hurrah together. Let's see if I can get this right. We're going to get in a cool little setting. Let's see what it looks like. Ah, look at that. All right. Can you both hear me?
Yeah.
Yep.
Perfect. Well, Jack and Jacqui, thank you so much for being here. Jacqui, I said earlier I wanted to come back to you in regards to your kids, but how has this impacted your kids and what are some things that you're doing with them right now to kind of start that process of just making them aware about the financial situation in your household?
Yeah, well, we still have a ways to go there, I think. But I think just them seeing us working together on it and then talking through. I mean, sometimes it's like, do you know how much money we spent on groceries this week? But them knowing that, the money comes in, but it also goes out. And I think that kids today don't know a whole lot about money coming in and going out because they're so used to seeing you swipe a card. They don't see you exchanging cash. And, they don't necessarily see that because it's all electronic. So I think that just hearing us talk about it, seeing us working together, they see us when we're on our mastermind group call. I think that's going to become ingrained. And I find them asking for things less. And, when they do ask for something, it's like, okay, well, how can we earn the money for that item? Rather than we were very much fly by the seat of our pants. We'd be like, oh, sure, go ahead and spend $20 on that game or whatever. Now it's more like, okay, what can you do around the house to earn the money because that's what we would have to do.
Yep.
And a funny thing is that, they want to get the money before they've done the job. So they're like, well, I'll do X, Y, and Z if you just give me the money now that I can spend. So we're like, okay, well, that's not how the real world works.
No,
we need to wait for our paycheck before we can spend it. We can't spend that money. We can't go to our employer and say, hey, can you just pay me ahead of time so that I can buy this thing? It doesn't work that way. So I think they're starting to get it a little bit more and more. I know it's a long process, but they're starting to get it.
Yeah, you guys are doing a super job too. Those are great tips. Those are super tips. Like I said, it'll change their life. Just think down the road where they'll be if they have their finances under control. So
yeah, I never remember talking to my parents about money. Yeah. Never.
Yeah, it's, and I think that's where we need to step up. Our generation needs to step up and really start what you're doing as you start educating your kids in the process. So, Good job. Super proud of you guys. Yeah. Jack, any last words before we part?
Keep your chin up. It's all going to get better eventually here.
Absolutely.
It will.
I want to come to Miami for a tan.
Yeah.
I got you.
Sign me up. What's that?
We do spray tans also, just to let you know.
Okay, that's good.
I've got one last question before I let you go, though, Jack. What happened to your finger? What's happened to his finger there?
Like you all were talking about, your biggest expense was food, right? Well, we decided to buy in bulk. And I'm a meat eater, so I was slicing up steaks.
Oh, that's right.
Putting them in freezer bags. And Doug, you know, I'm very handy with knives. I'm very comfortable with them. And I was
washing.
I was washing the utensils, and it slipped. And I just instinctively went to grab the knife, and it slid it down to the tendon.
Oh.
So. Yeah.
Oh, that's awful.
Yeah, it still moves. So I don't have stitches. I did all that stuff myself.
Oh, God.
He was like, stop. Well, that's a good note. You know.
I was smart on doing that.
Oh, right. Well,
It was good.
I'm glad I asked. I get crazy with that stuff. So if I pass out before the show ends, just let me.
I'd like to see that actually.
All right. Well,
Tammy will be doing curls, picking them up.
Thanks, Jacqui. Appreciate that.
Sorry.
All right. Well, thank you so much. It's been so fun, and I'm so excited to just have you share with all our people on social media. You guys are the best.
That's been great.
Give your family the best for me, and I'm going to put you in the holding tank, and I'm going to talk to you after the show. Does that sound good?
Bye, y'all.
Good.
All right. Thanks again. Aren't they great? Thank you so much, just both of you, for coming on board. And thank you for watching today. I really appreciate it. If you found this valuable, please share this with people that you love and care about. Share it on your pages. Tag them in the posts. We would love to continue to get the word out. And if there's anything we can ever do, just go to oneshotonelife.com. We've got, I can do one-on-one training. We've got mastermind groups, online courses. You can purchase the book. You can get it at amazon.com as well. And again, I hope this show is really beneficial for you. Thanks again for being here. I want to thank all my good friends. I want to thank Jacqui. I want to thank Jack. I want to thank Tammy, my wife over here. I want to thank my first live studio audience member, Brad over here, which has been really fun. And anyway, again, thank you so much for being here. We are so excited that you're here, and we look forward to bringing more great shows to you in the future. So with that, remember, you only have one shot at your amazing one life. So go out there and make every single day count. We'll see you next time, everyone.
Thank you for listening to the One Shot, One Life show. Visit OneShotOneLife.com to get a free download of our theme song. Join a mastermind group. Purchase one of our online courses and more. While you're there, learn how to connect with Doug on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. Go there now. OneShotOneLife.com. OneShotOneLife.com.